welcome back to Skirts and Words. This is the end of season two, amazingly enough. And I'm Denise, and I'm here with Jen, who owns Vault Books and Brew in Castle Rock, Washington. You should totally come by. And Taryn is an editor and also is a manager, the manager at Vault Books and Brew. So, welcome.
We are glad to have you.
I'm glad to be here.
Yeah. So, we all read It's Kind of a Funny Story, and that's what we're going to talk about.
When Taryn first started here, she kept talking about this book. Although, to be fair, she talked about a lot of books, which is why I hired her. But most of them are like, I am not going to read that. That's cute. I'm not going to read that.
She has a thing against vampire books, and I had a thing for them in high school. It's okay.
It's just a missed demographic there. Yes. But, however, she finally badgered me into reading this one. And I really resonated with this story. It starts with Craig, who is in high school. And he has contemplated suicide numerous times, and he finally goes to act on it, but then is brave enough to go and check himself into an inpatient-type clinic. And so it's the story of who he meets there, what he learns, that kind of thing. And so from that, I was thinking about May is Mental Health Awareness Month, which obviously we knew about and planned this ahead of time.
That's right.
Which is why we're talking about this book. But as it's Mental Health Awareness Month, I thought that it would be a good time to talk about these kind of issues. And we are seeing a lot of specifically young adult literature that's focused on mental health, that's focused on cutting and depression and anxiety and all kinds of different issues that weren't available when I was a kid, when I was cutting and anxious and all of these things. So it's really kind of a breath of fresh air, and it makes me feel hopeful for the next generation that we have more inclusive books, more empathetic books, books that touch on all kinds of different scenarios.
It's very interesting that you say that, because just, I think, 2 days ago, I was on Reddit. I'm on Reddit a lot. And somebody was asking for book recommendations for, I think, late middle school. And I can't remember what the recommendations were, but somebody was like, these books all have really heavy topics. I think it's too much for a middle schooler. And I'm like, I don't think you understand what middle schoolers deal with.
Mm-hmm.
I think that they're probably way more relevant than you.
Yeah, and had I been in middle school and read a book about cutting, which is what I was doing in middle school, right, it may have helped me stop doing that, like, in high school instead of being older.
Right.
So, and that was not a topic that I remember ever being brought up, really, until I read it in YM magazine, and I was like, okay.
Yeah.
That's cool, I do that. But that wasn't really, that didn't really help me any.
Right. Right.
But maybe some books would have.
Yeah.
When I was in middle school, I read a lot, but there was one, it's called Willow. I think we have it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's about a girl who cuts, and it's about how they try and stop her,
mm-hmm.
and how she's going through all these different things. It didn't resonate with me because I wasn't cutting,
mm-hmm.
but I had anxiety. I had the depression, and what she was thinking resonated with me.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't remember the full story, but I remember reading it and being like, I don't have that in me to cut because I don't like pain,
mm-hmm.
but I felt a lot, and I was like, I feel enough anxiety and pain inside. I was like, I can't cut, but it probably would have helped you a lot, because
mm-hmm.
in the end, she's like, why, it's similar to this, it's like, why am I doing all these
mm-hmm.
things? I should be able, like, I think it ends with her going to a therapist or something like that.
But it was nice to see your feelings reflected
yeah.
back in a character that,
yeah.
yeah.
And that's why when I read this when I was in high school, I was so relieved, because throughout the whole novel, Craig is talking about how, why shouldn't he be depressed? Why am I depressed? This doesn't make any sense. It would make so much more sense if I was abused, if I had all these things
mm-hmm.
going on. And I was like, yes, why am I constantly sad? Why
right.
do I just want to sleep all the time? And I was the kid that was in honors classes my sophomore year. I was in AP literature, or AP history, honors literature. I was a year above in my science class. And I was just doing constantly a lot. And then my junior and senior year, I was in college. And I was going there for three. I was in the college for three classes. I was taking a class at the high school. I had a job. I was constantly doing something. And so when I reread it, and I was like, I need to, like, slow down, because this is going to burn me out.
Mm-hmm.
This is where I'm going to be. And I love Craig's journey. I just don't want to partake in going to Six North.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. It. I spent a lot of time hanging out in therapy offices and mental floors, usually in the visitor section. But like when his family comes to visit him, I'm like, that is exactly what it's like. And you've got the patients who are just like around the corner. They're like, oh, that guy's got a family, and it's a surreal thing.
I think that's part of why I think this book is so good, because you can tell, like, this isn't just fiction. Like, this is definitely a fictionalized account of something that he absolutely went through.
Right.
And every character in there is someone that he has encountered, because when you see these characters, you're like, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or when you read his character, like, the thoughts that he's thinking, you're like, yeah, that's, yeah, definitely been there.
And there was a part in here that I was talking to you about the other day where he's talking about, well, if I can't do this, then I can't work. And if I don't work, I don't do this. And if I can't do that, I can't do this. And he, in most of the passages, he's talking in third person, not the book's in first person point of view, but when he's thinking, he's like, Craig, if you don't do this, then you're going to fail and all these things. But then at this one point, he's talking about work and not school, and I was like, I feel like that was a lot of the author, Ned Vizzini, coming out in what he was writing. And there were certain points where I felt like he's talking to himself, but also to the reader through Craig in a different way than he is throughout the rest of it.
Yeah.
I feel like it was probably just as therapeutic for him to write that as it is for people to read that now, later on. I had a point.
So when you first invited me, we were talking about the difference between how your generation handles mental illness and how mine does.
Right. So that is what I was thinking of in the car on the way back over here. So there's 15 years difference between us, and I feel every 15 of those years sometimes when we're working together in that, not that I feel like ancient, but, and this is a good thing, it's a good thing, just in the shift between this generation, like super, you're millennial, like you're in there, you're not on the cusp, like I'm the cusp of Gen Y or Gen X and millennial, very open, like Taryn has discussions with her friends about mental illness and about how they're feeling and all of these things, like really deep, touchy-feely conversations that make me super uncomfortable, because I legitimately feel like Clint Eastwood when she's talking with her friends, because I'm like, suck it up, my God. But that's not okay. Like, that's where a lot of people my age and older have these, like, repressed anger and anxiety and issues and resentments and all of these things because, and maybe it was just my family, maybe it was just the religion I grew up in. Like, yeah, I mean, you can talk, you can be sad if you, like,
have a reason,
but you can't just not have a reason.
Right.
Like, look at everything you have, and Jesus is here for you, and all of these things. And so, I don't remember a lot of conversations with my friend group about actual mental illness things, about actual suicidal ideation, or actual, I don't know, actual things other than, like, she's a bitch. You know?
And, I mean,
you have those too, to be fair, but no, it's just, I really feel a lot of anticipation, and I know that a lot of people that watch certain stations on TV feel like, this generation is rooting us into the ground, pansies, we hate them, blah, blah, America, but I feel like this generation, my son's generation, my son's 12 and my other son's 8, they are so much more empathetic. They're so much more welcoming of any kind of mental illness or fluidity or any kind of thing. Like, they're just like, oh, yeah, that's fine. Whereas in my generation, we're like, mm.
See, I was a totally weird kid. Well, I was really lucky because, I guess, because I literally, like, as soon as I was old enough to drive, I was driving my mom to all of her appointments. And so I was just, like, I had a subscription to psychology magazines. Like,
I did read that for fun. Psychology Today?
Yeah.
That magazine was the bomb.
When I was, like, I think 13
this is why
or something.
Friends.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then when I was younger, I was probably 20. I was out of high school, but I got to be really good friends with another lady who also had the same weird growing up in a therapist's office mm-hmm. experience. And so we have all kinds of conversations. But I know that that is not the norm
yeah.
for anybody else that I knew.
And I'm thinking, like, school-wise, too. In school,
yeah.
I mean, we talked about, like, a little bit, like, bullying and stuff, but not to the depths that they talk about it now.
Well, it was just, like, only bullying.
Yeah.
And it was only, at least in our school, it was only directed at the bully.
Yeah.
Like, that end of it, there was no discussion of, like, what does that do to the person that you're attacking?
Mm-hmm.
How do they feel? And if you're being bullied, what should you do beyond, you know, tattling on them?
Yeah.
Really.
That's basically how my middle school was. My middle school experience was when they came out with that long documentary called, like, bully or
mm-hmm.
something like
mm-hmm.
that. It was some one-word phrase. It was, like, bullying or bully. And we all had to sit in the big auditorium-type space and watch this for hours. And I remember sitting there, and I'm optimistically pessimistic kind of thing, where I'm like, yeah, everything's going to be fine, but like, eh, we're all going to die someday kind
right.
of thing.
Right.
We'll all find peace one day. And I was watching it, and I was like, this is not going to change literally anyone. I'm sorry. You're not having the correct discussion with us. At like 12, I was watching this, and I was like, this is so pointless to like the people that are bullying, because they do not care. At least the ones I knew.
Right.
The ones I knew were bullying. I was like, they don't care. This isn't the conversation to have. You shouldn't just throw us all in an auditorium, all of my entire class. Like, it was, like, my entire class, and maybe even the entire school just sat and watched this, and I was like, this is not going to change anything. It's not the conversation. It's not the way to go about this. And they would always just tell us the same thing, where it was like, hey, don't make fun of people. And
right.
it's like, okay, but then, like, Jen and I make fun of each other all the time, and it's not.
And it's fun.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
Right.
It's so much fun. But it was also weird, because there was also this weird mentality where if you had a mental illness, even when we were in middle school or older, it was like this badge of honor that you hid, but it was there. Because people talked about cutting themselves all the time in my middle school. And it was, like, something they were proud of. They're like,
mm-hmm.
yeah, I cut on my leg. And I was like, I'm sorry, are you okay? I was like, I can't do that. Like, do you? And I remember one time I tried, because I was like, I need to be like them. And I was like, no, this is, nope, I don't want to do that. I was like, nope, this hurts, don't like it.
Well, and he talks about that in
yeah.
the book, where, like, he wants to keep his depression, like, a total secret. He doesn't want anyone to know that he's in the hospital. Somebody finds out, and
mm-hmm.
word gets around, and now he's getting phone calls from girls who are like, oh, I'm all so sad, and I didn't have any idea that you were so deep, and
I was like, that was, I actually highlighted one of my mini sticky notes, because I was like, that's a double-edged sword with our generation, where we are more open to having
mm-hmm.
that discussion in general, but it's this double-edged thing where it's like, you can have this discussion,
mm-hmm.
but then there's going to probably be a lot of people. And I never want to take someone's mental illness away. I never want to take their struggle away. I mean, like, I would love for them not to be mentally ill.
Right.
But I never want to take that struggle away from them if they're dealing with that and what they've been through. But there are a lot of people I met in college who would party
mm-hmm.
all night. And I realize that this can be a symptom. But they would party all night, and then they'd wake up the next day hungover, and they'd message me because I would be going to class, because no matter how much I wanted to die, you still have to get up, and you still have to do a job, and you still
mm-hmm.
have to go to school and do everything. They'd be like, yeah, I can't go. Today's a really bad depression day. And I'm like,
yeah.
And then they would blame the professor for not helping them. And he would, like, one of my classes, you literally didn't have to go. It was a Shakespeare class. Didn't have to go. All you had to do was read the play and comment on some, like, if you weren't in class, you just had to go into the discussion board and comment. And people in there would be like, I just can't. I can't do it. And I'm like, why? Why can you not do it? I don't, in that to me, it would irk me, because they're like, yeah, I have anxiety and I have depression, and, like, you know, you should care and you should do things for me. And I'm like, absolutely not.
It's
sorry.
Such a fine line between attention seeking
mm-hmm.
and that too, because I know people are like, oh, I have to get Social Security because I can't go outside my house. And I'm like, oh,
yeah.
I don't know.
And there's people with like agoraphobia who legitimately cannot go outside their house. And I'm like, do not. You're making this really serious conversation that's finally getting more attention to it, and pulling, like, you're making it seem less important than it is, because the people that are experiencing you are like, you're living off the system, you're doing all these things, and it's like, no, that's not, please stop being an advocate for it, because you're not giving it a good example.
Yeah, because the people that are really, really struggling are not the ones that are proclaiming it from the top of the
They're
rooftop.
Not usually on Instagram.
Yeah.
Or they're on Instagram, but they're not, they're making everything look like it's fine.
Yeah.
And that's really, it's really difficult. I did like that his internal dialogue is like a drill sergeant.
I
like,
do too.
Like, what are you doing, soldier?
Yeah.
I love that, yeah. I listened to it on, for the past week or so, and I loved hearing it because the way he would change his voice.
Mm-hmm.
What are you doing there, soldier? Do you think you can make it in the army? No. And I was just like, yes. This is exactly what it sounds like.
So I don't think there's, like, true depression and then, like, fake depression. I mean, I just feel like that's the kind of thing where if you keep going and you keep going and you keep going and you keep doing, even though you have this, like, that's a sign that you could... I don't know.
It's hard because I don't want to ever take, because I know the people that I was experiencing were suffering with stuff, but it would drive me nuts when they would just be like, nope, I can't do anything, and I'm like, but if you can go out and party, you can go and do these things. You can do, I don't know, and I realize it's different, and I like.
Well, and I think a lot of, generalizing, I think that some people don't have the drive, or maybe the education, or maybe the support to put that energy into self-care, like true self-care. And so then you run out of energy trying to make yourself feel good, and then you're done.
And
whereas if you go to therapy and they teach you all the coping skills and all the stuff, you can redirect all the chaos, I guess.
Well, and I think a lot of it, because I can try to solve anything books, and so I think that changing the conversation or the types of books, so I try to have really inclusive, specifically in children's and young adults, I try to have really inclusive books, because I think you can start there with something really approachable, something really like, oh, I started reading a book about I've got one called something about stripes about autism. Like, so that when you reach middle school, you're familiar with what that looks like, and you're not like, he's weird.
Right.
So we've got, what's that, Polka Dot, the one about the we have a transgender.
Oh, IMJ?
Well, there's that. Oh, that's the young adult one, but then we just got one in.
It's like a graphic
one.
Novel thing that's about transgender. I saw it last time I was
here.
Oh,
Late Bloomer?
Super Late Bloomer?
I think so.
I have it right over on the counter. Yeah. So I have that one. I have, oh, no, I was saying bye. I have that one by Julia Kay, which has been really, really good. Actually, I've ordered that several times for people, just talking about the transition. I have ones about adopted families, like what it feels like to be adopted, foster children. I have different races. I have different, you know, I try to have as much of that as possible, because then it normalizes that, you know,
right,
for people, and it's not a shock. Which in this community, when you grow up in a town of 2,000 people and it's like 99% white, you don't get a lot of diversity in a lot of stuff. So I think that just making sure that all the literature is inclusive, I think that helps as you get older.
Well, I think that books like you're talking about in this one are important for people who don't experience any of those things, because a lot of times, like... like you're talking about in a small town, a lot of people, they don't even have a concept.
Yeah, so it comes from fear. Like, bullying comes from fear. You don't look like me, and I don't like that. It makes me uncomfortable, so I'd rather just be like, you're awful, and I hate you, and I'm going to beat you up. Like,
right.
Obviously, I'm really bad at being a bully.
But,
rawr.
And it can also come from the point of, like, well, you're expressing what I can't express to others, what I'm dealing with, too, so that pisses me off. Like,
yeah,
don't, why do you get to do this and I can't?
Mm-hmm.
which goes back to like where they would go to class. I'm like, why do you get to do this and I can't do that for myself?
Yeah,
yeah.
I definitely understand that. I definitely feel that too.
And I definitely need to be more empathetic. I should put that out there. It's really hard though, because I'm
we're all on a journey.
So I actually wrote a paper. My degree in college was history. I graduated with it, everything like that, from Wazoo Gokooks. But we had to write this paper. I had to write a paper, and it was about whatever I wanted it to be about. So I wrote about mental illness through literature, and I wrote about Jane Eyre. It's kind of a funny story, a book called Liar, and then Herland. Have you read that before?
I have not.
That one's a really interesting one. It was published in 1915. I cannot remember the author's name for the life of me. But it's about these three men that crash in, like, South America or something like that, and they discovered this civilization of women that have just survived, like, without men. There's no men there. It's really interesting. But it was interesting to see the growth and also the step backs that literature would take, because there was one book I read. It's called Liar. It's by Justine Barster, something. It's a really long last name. And it's about this girl who constantly lies, like, throughout the whole novel to you. She legitimately comes out and goes, I'm a werewolf at one point, and that's why this is all happening. And it had such a, this is a really strong claim, disgusting view of mental health, because she talks about how I have to take a pill every morning or else I'm gonna go crazy, like, I'm gonna go wolf. And, like, you could, it was so very thinly veiled, obvious that she's relating it to mental health, or even to, like, just being a woman kind of thing, where, like, you might have to take a pill so you don't get pregnant and things like that. And it was published not that far behind, behind. It's kind of a funny story, and there are other books I've read where I'm just like, what is happening? Why are you discussing mental health in this way, where it makes people, a kid can pick this book up, look in it, read it, and get the completely wrong take about dealing, or about having to take pills, because if I don't take my pill, I'm going to turn into a werewolf and kill people. And it's like, you should take your pills, you should be healthy, but why are you telling them that if they don't take their pills, they're going to, like, destroy their life and others' lives? Like, that's not a way to go. But there were so many, like, even in the United States, there's court cases where if you had a mental illness, there was literally a court case in the Supreme Court in 1926, where a Supreme Court justice said, there's three generations of imbeciles here, and that is enough. And he was talking about sterilizing a 9-month-old infant before she even had the ability to talk. And so I'm like, we've come so far to the point where we can read a story like this and see his journey. And he's very clearly has been ingrained with stigmas about mental illness, because he talks about how he doesn't want to call it a landing bed because it makes him uncomfortable. And he talks about how he shouldn't be depressed and how he should just get over it and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Which, like you said, why are you sad?
Mm-hmm.
There's no reason, kind of thing. And then to read other novels and see it handled so carelessly for a younger audience, like, really stressed me out. Like, Liar is the only book I have ever, like, I cut the front cover out, or the front page out, and I didn't ruin any of the words, despite the fact how bad I wanted to, because I was trying to make a poster for a class, and I wanted to just burn it, because I was like, this is the worst book I have, the character was awful, the writing wasn't, I was so upset. I came into class, and I had literally 12 pages of notes, and my teacher's like, oh, you liked it? And I was like, why would you have us read this book? And she's like, what do you mean? And I was like, do you not see, like, the thinly veiled, like, mocking institutionalization and, like, how she mocks having to be in a mental ward and how she does all this? She's like, oh, I hadn't really thought of that. And I was like, you probably should, because if you want me to teach this to a child, you're insane, because I will never hand this to a kid.
So that's one we shouldn't order.
No, never.
So that's my reaction to The Giving Tree.
Which I still haven't read.
You haven't read The Giving Tree?
Based on the fact that you told me
that it is a codependent dumpster fire?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I haven't read it.
But then know that it's a codependent dumpster fire of a book.
See,
but then know that generations grew up being like, The Giving tree. And I'm like, pick every tree.
So I had never read it before I came here. And then she's like, have you read this? And I said, no. And she goes, it's awful. And so I read it, and I was like, what is this book? Why are you?
And it's like a treasured children's book. It's, I could go on about that book for a long time.
You probably would have like 20 pages.
I would, yeah. But I was thinking, I just had a brilliant thought, and I don't remember where it went, but I think it was something about, Liar had an unreliable narrator. And then I think that's how it feels, I know that's how it feels, to have depression, like, because your whole life is being narrated by an unreliable narrator who tells you, like, the world would be so much better if you were dead, so you should do that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that was a profound thought. I should write that down.
Put that on a pillow.
On film. Yeah.
There you go.
Cross stitch it on a pillow.
Your
brain is an unreliable narrator.
Trademark that. No, and that's the crazy thing. Or, like, any mental illness, you have, like, just an unreliable narrator. Because I deal with, like, OCD and stuff like that, where I'm like, oh, if I don't do this, then the world will burn. Makes no sense. Could be completely illogical, but I'm like, oh, if I don't do that, the world's gonna burn. Okay.
Well, you've been doing really good so far, because we're still here, so.
That's true,
yes. Yeah. I guess.
You're welcome. I worked really hard. But there are some days where I'm just like, you know what, I'm gonna challenge it, and then the whole, I won't do it, and then the, like, whatever task my head creates for me, the whole day, I'll just be like, something's bad's gonna happen. And, like, my mom has created, my mom, so, you're in a similar generation to my mom.
Mm-hmm.
My,
she's hashtag old.
I should be fair to you, my mom had me when she was young. Mm-hmm. So, you're not, she's only 4 years older than you, I think.
Seriously?
She was 20 when she had me.
I'm 37.
So she was 20 when she had me, and then right after...
How old is she right now?
43. So, is she 5 years older?
Six.
What? Then you were 16 when I was... You were 15. Never
15.
Mind.
I always swear that she was a daughter I forgot I had. Like, and just put her somewhere.
My mom stole me.
She did.
It happens.
It does.
She suffers, I know she does, from a lot of anxiety. And she'll be like, no, I'm fine. But she just handles it very differently than I do. And it makes her very uncomfortable when I will sit down with her. And I've been like, because I was supposed to go back to school and get my master's degree, and I just couldn't. And Jen can attest to this. She's seen many a breakdown of me being like, I cannot do this. And I remember staring at my mom, sobbing, and I said, Mom, I wanted to kill myself. Legitimately end my life, drive off a cliff, die. And she was like, well, everyone's had those thoughts. And I was like, no, that's not good. Why have you? And I went to therapy and stuff in Pullman because it was free. And I haven't gone since because it's not free. But I remember she would tell me, like, yeah, I used to have those thoughts all the time. And I was like, no.
That's not normal.
I was like, no, that's not. And she's fine now, but, like, she has this, like, if she doesn't know where Nate and my little brother or I are at night and she's going to bed, she cannot sleep at all because she's constantly worried that we're, like, dead in a ditch.
Mm-hmm.
So I know she has anxiety, but she was never allowed to really discuss it.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes, I talk about it all the time. I, like, will talk to my grandma about it, and it makes her uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
And I've finally broken them of being like, well, just, like, don't be sad. And now they go, well, are you taking medication? Do you need to go take medication? And I'm like, yes,
mm-hmm.
I do. I need it. But I'm okay. But it's really weird. It was a really weird transition for them, because I would be like, yeah, so I hate school, and they'd be like, well, you're doing so well, and I was like, yes, but I want to die, and they'd be like, no, you don't want to die, and I'm like, yes, I do. I've burnt myself out. I've been going to college since I was 16. I am ready to be over with it. And it was a really weird thing to think that they had never had those conversations with friends. But again, I didn't have those same kind of deep conversations with people until I went to college,
mm-hmm.
until I experienced people around me who were like, no, I have that same thing. I can't sleep at night, and I have panic attacks, and I do all this stuff. And it was just so comforting, like reading this
mm-hmm.
book, to be able to sit and be like, wait, so you're functioning, but you're not.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I've had doctors, like, look at me and talk to me, and they've been like, how are you walking?
I think that a lot.
Yeah. They're like, how are you, like,
how are you upright today?
Yeah, they're like, how are you, like, handling everything? I'm like, because what's the other option?
Yeah.
I'm like, my only other option is death, and I can't do that. My mom would be sad, and I can't make her sad.
I think, I know, I definitely have had that, and what is my other option? Like, when people are like, well, how did you do that? What else is there? What else am I going to do? Like,
right.
Not do that? I don't know. And maybe that's a testament to, like, our families being like, there's not another option, you know?
Exactly.
But in a good way. I don't know. Not in a bad way, just...
We were never allowed to stop. I remember, like, everything. When I told my mom, I was like, I don't think I want to do running start. She was, like, slammed on the brakes because we were in the car. And she's like, what do you mean? And I was like, okay, I'll do it.
Just kidding.
I was like, never mind, I'll do it. Whatever you want me to do, just tell me what to do. But I was never given the option to, like, stop. If I told my mom, hey, I'm feeling sad or I'm feeling depressed today, I can't go to school, she'd be like, laugh.
Yeah.
And go, that really sucks. Go to school.
Yeah.
If I wasn't throwing up, I had to go to school.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was like, I was trained. I never got that. You couldn't just, like, take a day for mental health. And I still do not understand that. And I should be more empathetic because I do understand how hard it is.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not, because I'm like, I get up every day. You should get up every day. Unless you literally can't. And there's people who can, and there's people who can't. Choose not to.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not fair of me to assert, but
you're gonna be a Clint Eastwood monster like me.
Yeah, I am. My kids are gonna be like, Mom, da, da, da. I'm like, we're talking about that. We're not talking about that.
Yeah, they'll turn out fine.
Yeah.
Do we have any other quips about, we have already gone through like our time.
We totally have.
I know. Any other mental health, mental illness,
mental health?
Mental health.
That's where I'm at. What? I'm fine. Everything's fine. Well,
I think if you're wanting to understand depression, it's kind of a funny story is a good place to start. Because he's definitely, like, high-functioning depression.
Mm-hmm.
Although he realizes he's the dumbest kid in the smart class. Which, you know, is a real testament to, like, he works so hard
mm-hmm.
to get into that school.
I have been that kid.
And then, oh, but you have to keep working hard. Like,
yeah.
So I think it's really good for people who have not been around depression or totally don't understand.
If you have a partner with depression and you are not understanding what they're saying, read this book. It's an easy read. It's not like it's Moby
Dick.
It's
audible. And it's
yeah.
Yeah. Easy. And really the internal dialogue portions are, like you said, it's really a good representation of, like, what runs through your brain while you're trying to figure out why you can't.
Yeah,
because
sometimes when you think of a depressed person, you think of, like, oh, that homeless person, that's why he's homeless, because he's real sad. Like, he's in AP classes, he's succeeding, and so you're like, oh, it can be normal people.
Yeah.
And he does that spiral, where he's like, oh, if I don't turn off 5 of my labs, then I can't pass science. If I don't pass science, I won't have a perfect 98, GPA or whatever, and if I don't have that, then I won't get into a good college, and if I don't get into a good college, I can't make enough money, and if I don't make enough money, I won't be able to pay for the pills I need. If I can't take the pills I need, then I can't go to work, and if I can't go to work, I'm going to live on the street and be homeless, and then how am I supposed to have a family and a car?
Every day of middle school, that was me, and what's so funny is that, speaking of mental health awareness, another great book that I read was Valedictorian of Being Dead, which has been a lot for me to handle, but that was her exact same spiral through college and through everything else, is I'm going to end up homeless in a dumpster. And that was mine, too. Like, I'm going to end up homeless in a dumpster. Why? Where do we get this? I don't know. Well, anyway, if you don't watch our podcast, you're going to end up alone in a dumpster. So, anyway, I hope that you have enjoyed it. We have enjoyed every moment of your watching. So, thanks for coming.
Bye.
Dumpster fire with
this
the Giving
is a good
Tree.
Movie, by the way.
Yeah.
They did a good movie out of